Good afternoon, everyone. I request all the participants to be seated. The seminar is about to commence. A very good afternoon to all of you. This seminar has been organized by Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, IBBI, in association with the Indian Institute of Insolvency Professionals of ICAI and the National E-Governance Services Limited as part of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav celebrations. On behalf of IBBI, IIIP, ICAI, and NESL, I welcome you to this seminar being held through the in-person as well as the online mode. I now invite our guest of honor, Honorable Member NCLT, Shri Venkata Subbarao Hari, Old-time Member IBBI, Shri Sudhakar Shuklaji, Deputy Managing Director, State Bank of India, Shri Subroto Biswas, MD and CEO of IIIP ICAI.
Recording in progress.
MD and CEO of IIIP ICAI, Mr. Rahul Madan, MD and CEO, National E-Governance Services Limited, Shri Dev Jyoti Ray Chaudhary, to come forward for the lighting of the lamp. We are also honored to have the champion of IIIP ICAI, Dr. Ashok Haldia, who could not come in person, but has kindly consented to join through the online mode. Sir, please.
Shubham Kurutvam Kalyanam Arogyam Jana Sampada Shatru Buddhi Vinashaya Deepat Jyotir Namostute Deepat Jyotir Namostute Shubham Kurutvam Kalyanam Arogyam Jana Sampada.
Thank you, sir. I now request all the guests of honor to please take their seat on the dais. Sir, this way, sir, please. Thank you, sir. I shall now like to invite MD and CEO of NESL, Shri Dev Jyoti Ray Chaudhary, to welcome the guests of honor and the participants in this seminar. Shri Ray Chaudhary is an MBA from the Faculty of Management Studies, Delhi, and certified associate of the Indian Bank Institute of Bankers. He is a passionate leader with a long track record of successfully managing assignments of a diverse nature. Immediately prior to joining NESL, he was Chief General Manager of the State Bank of India on deputation to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. At IBBI, he took some path-breaking initiatives like the implementation of the company's Registered Valuer and Valuation Rules 2017. His articles on the issues related to insolvency have been published in reputed publications, national newspapers, and he has been a speaker in numerous seminars and workshops related to the corporate insolvency and also in the educational institutions like the national law universities. So I request you to please deliver your welcome address.
Honorable Venkata Subba Rao Hari, Member NCLT Mumbai, respected Sri Sudhakar Shukla, whole-time member IBBI, Dr. Ashok Haldia, Chairman IIIP, Sri Shubhrata Biswas, Deputy Managing Director, State Bank of India, Sri Rahul Madan, CEO, MD and CEO, IIIP ICI. At the outset, I would like to thank IBBI for having this seminar on digitalization of the corporate insolvency resolution process. I'm also grateful to Sri Sudhakar Shukla sir, Dr. Ashok Haldia, and Mr. Rahul Madan for their unstinted support towards organizing this event commemorating Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. It is often said that IBC gave the firms the freedom to exit, the extremely important third freedom, which was till then absent in the reforms undertaken in the Indian economy. As you are aware, the liberalization of the Indian economy starting from the early 90s first paved the way for the freedom to entry and subsequently the freedom to do business for firms. Today, we are celebrating another freedom, the freedom from paper, the freedom from being desk bound and room bound, freedom from the worry of data loss. And all this through the platform for distressed assets service providers impaneled by IBBI. I'm happy to note that the COVID-19 pandemic seems to have somewhat eased. And that's why we are having this kind of a seminar in hybrid mode after a long time. However, the lessons from the pandemic need to be learned. The COVID-19 pandemic brought about disruption in normal life and business like never before. However, it also brought to the fore the importance of technology and online services. Even in the worst moments of the lockdown, essential services, food delivery, payment services, financial markets, and to a large extent, online shopping, not only continued, but showed robust growth. Technology made this possible. And the facilitators for the same, the IT industry, is showing such a robust growth that there are multiple demands on good talent and the industry does not seem to have enough of it. In the insolvency space, IBBI had this vision of an online marketplace much before the pandemic hit us. NESL has further developed this platform to provide a comprehensive suite of services to take care of all requirements under CIRP and liquidation. So what are the advantages of using a technology solution like the platform for distressed assets? The advantages are manifold. Firstly, it helps in achieving insolvency resolution within the timeline by bringing in efficiencies in all processes. Then it's totally digital and it's fully in sync with Digital India initiatives. Today, we are celebrating Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And Digital India is one of the achievements of a vibrant new India. In fact, one of the areas in which India has surpassed China is in digital payments. Use of the PDA also expands the size of the market and leads to better price discovery. Value of an entity like beauty often lies in the eyes of the beholder. A potential bidder is often looking at synergies from an acquisition through the resolution route. For him, the opportunity cost of losing an asset is more important than the standalone valuation of the target asset. That's why valuation, while being important, to have a benchmark, but what is equally important is one, marketing of the assets, two, price discovery. And this can happen only if there's a wide participation across all geographies on a platform which can inspire confidence of all stakeholders. Use of technology is certainly the only way forward. However, information security is equally important. In my discussions with IPs during my visit to UK, I came to learn that this was one of the primary concerns. In India, also this has become equally important. NESL has an information security policy and a security framework which is compliant with ISO 27001:2013 requirements. It also adheres to RBI guidelines on cybersecurity framework. Data security and privacy is ensured in the NESL information utility application. The NESL IU application is hosted in a tier 4 data center with the primary and disaster recovery centers located in different seismic zones. IT business continuity plan is as per the guidelines on technical standards issued by IBBI. Besides that, NESL also conducts audits at regular intervals, including the quarterly VAPT audits of IU software, yearly audit of office IT infrastructure, yearly audit of the data center, etc. There is also an audit of the IT framework, interface, and data processing systems as envisaged in the IBBI IU regulations. This report is examined by the board of NESL and also by IBBI. NESL is being advised on all technology matters, including security and specs, by a technology committee comprising eminent persons in the field of information technology. At this seminar today, we are having a galaxy of eminent speakers. I extend a hearty welcome to all of them, and I'm extremely grateful to all of them for having spared their valuable time to contribute towards the deliberations. as we celebrate Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, I look forward to hearing the views of our distinguished speakers and participants on how we can carry forward the success of all the Digital India initiatives into the insolvency space. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for setting the tone for the seminar with your thoughts and views of how digitalization can facilitate the insolvency resolution process. Our next speaker is Shri Subrato Biswas. Shri Biswas is Deputy Managing Director of Stress Asset Resolution Group, also known as SARGI, of the State Bank of India. He is based in the bank's corporate office in Mumbai and has previously handled various assignments in the corporate accounts group, mid-corporate group, and risk management department. He has also worked in Paris for 3 years and London branches of the banks for 4 years. So we are honored to have you, and we request you to share your valuable insights. I request all the participants to put their hands together to welcome Shri Biswas.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the onset, let me thank Mr. Roy Choudhury for inviting me over to speak. It's a privilege to be here. IBC has been in existence from May 2016. The primary purpose of setting up of IBC was that the time taken from the date an account becomes stressed to realization of the dues to the lending institution are shortened. We have seen a lot of deliberations on this, on the different rules and regulations which has been governing IBC. And we have felt that over a period of time, there has been significant ease in doing business for the banking sector, which has been recognized by global bodies as well. With the onset of COVID-19, it was felt, and it became a necessity as well, that things move towards digital settlements. These disruptions on account of COVID and delays have highlighted the problem where a modern, effective, market-oriented, and well-drafted code can face challenges of delay and loss due to various reasons which need not be deliberated upon at this juncture. However, the writing is on the wall that digitization is the only way forward. India is a recognized world power as far as software development is concerned. And our software engineers are developing some of the most complex solutions, be it defense, be it space, be it banking, be it railways, all very large institutions in their own rights. In banking, we have a term called TAT, turnaround time. This turnaround time has been a challenge for most of us. However, a country as large as ours have shown through various effective programs initiated by the government in the last few years that we can rise to the occasion. We have digital platforms for almost everything. As Mr. Rajadev mentioned, be it delivery of food or essential items, medical treatment, payment of direct benefits, wages, etc. However, it's our thought that we are perhaps a tad behind the rest of the world as far as recovery of stressed assets are concerned. It's high time that we assimilate and apply our experiences and prowess in software engineering and software development to the ecosystem of IBC, that is working of NCLTs, IBBI, COCs, marketing of resolution plans, including admission of stressed assets into NCLT through a digitized platform. If we look at the basic structure of the code, there are perhaps very few points where adjudicating authority must really apply the judicial mind. For example, the admission of CIRP is based on three checks: existence of debt, occurrence of default beyond rupees 1 crore, and filing of petition within the limitation period. As mentioned, I had the experience of working in an overseas center, more particularly London. In UK, the laws are very simple. The borrower is called, he is asked, did you apply for this debt? Did you get the debt? Did you sign the security documents? And have you repaid the debt? If the answer to the first three questions are yes, and that of the fourth is no, then the process of collection of debt commences. And in most of the cases, it's concluded in 21 days. I also wish that in our country, we are able to resolve CIRP cases, if not within 21 days, at least within 210 days. I understand that NESL has developed some software and also is in the process of developing further, these softwares further, which can provide end-to-end solution to a resolution professional to conduct and complete the entire CIRP process online, including filing of petitions, reply to courts, compliance reports to IBBI, NCLT, sharing of minutes, organizing meetings and communication with stakeholders, even marketing for resolution plans, etc. Such software should go a long way in facilitating time-bound completion of CIR. I congratulate NES for such effort and would suggest to continue enhancing the capabilities of this software to provide more and more solutions to RPs and liquidators. We have observed that the maximum delay at NCLTs happen at admission stage and then subsequently at the stage of approval of resolution plans. With the adoption of this online filing, lot of petitioners and courts time, including that of the banks, can be saved. If the admission process is also digitized, then all delays at the initiation stage will be a thing of the past and lead to maximization of value of assets of corporate debtor with early resolutions. Well, that's all that I had to say at this point in time. With these words, I would like to thank NESL for giving me the opportunity to speak and hope that NESL's efforts in the directions of digitization bring a large contribution to the entire ecosystem and evolution of IBC. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your experience with the participants. Our next speaker is Dr. Ashok Haldia. Dr. Haldia is the chairman of IIIP ICAI and former MD and CEO of PTC India Financial Services Limited. He is a member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and the former secretary of the ICAI. For more than 10 years, from 1997 to 2008, he was also a member of the Appellate Tribunal for the ICAI, ICSI, ICWAI, set up by the Government of India. He has been recognized by the South Asian Federation of Accountants for his contribution in its growth and development. So I now request you to share your thoughts.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great pleasure for us as a IIIPI to get associated with the NESL in this webinar, such an important webinar on the topic of digitization and use of technology into the IBC services. Mr. Shukla, the member of the IIIPI, the members of the NCLT, the Managing Director, State Bank of India, the Managing Director, NESL, and also the Managing Director, IIIPI. Indeed, a great pleasure to be on the dais with such a distinguished personality from all those who are stakeholders to the NESL. I recall a couple of years ago, when I was dealing with the distressed assets in a different capacity heading a financial institution. And I was wondering how to infuse the transparency into the process, how to make available all the information to all the stakeholders at the same time, how to ensure the authenticity and the integrity of the information that we as institutions are providing to the bidders, to the creditors, other creditors, and also how to believe on the integrity of the information that the other stakeholders are providing to us. There were many coordinational issues that we came across. Are you able to see me? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. We are able to.
But I'm not able to see anybody of you there. No problem.
Lightings have been dimmed for your video tubers.
Okay. So I was wondering in terms of the coordination required with the different institutions and the different stakeholders, the bidders, the debtors, and at the same time, ensuring the transparency of the process. And we definitely feel the need of institution like NESL. Of course, the IBC was in place and IBC provided for a mechanism of information utility. But we were aghast by the time that it was taking. I know this was an innovation, a new thing in the Indian context. It bound to take time. But we always felt the sooner it comes, better it would be for the sake of disposal of the distressed assets. And now NESL in this present format is there, and we have a platform. We have a platform for distressed assets, for the virtual data room, and great service to the insolvency professionals, to the liquidators, and also to the IBC. I used to wonder as to when a data to be provided to the investors and in what format the data to be provided. There has to be a technology symmetry between the user of the data and the provider of the data. the access to the data and access to the data at the given point of time. And knowing that at that point of time, the data secrecy and data privacy is maintained. Now we have NESL's PDA platform for distress assets. And I can understand and I can realize how important, how useful the organizations and information utility and organization like NESL has been. It's a repository of legal evidence. That's one thing. Second thing is that the data, the information about the debts and the claims, and authenticate information verified by the concerned parties, provided by the concerned parties, and available to all those who need, to the creditors. And we know the time requirement under the IBC. And that time requirement, within that time requirement, providing the information, making it available, perusal of that, is in itself a task. And when we have an electronic platform of NESL, I'm sure that that helps a good deal in time-bound resolution. And as I said, information asymmetry, that was a great challenge, because if there is information asymmetry, even to a smallest extent, then that's a challenge to the integrity, to the transparency of the process. And as a management, one was always concerned about as to how to minimize, how to not only minimize, how to remove it at all. You cannot allow information asymmetry, the lack of transparency, the lack of secrecy of the data provided by even a single percent. And that's constant challenge. And I'm sure the NESL and the platform for the distress assets has been of great use. And when I took over as a chairman of the IIIPI, I thought that's something area that we must focus. And when NESL platform came, we did have a frequent interaction with the NESL and quite productive interactions. We did did floated a questionnaire to our members as to why there has not been effective use of NESL platform despite being so useful. What is that can be done? Is it a technology related problem? Is it a cost related problem? Is it an interface between the users and the NESL platform? Or is it because asymmetry between what the NESL provides and what the user believe or user feel or user understand what NESL provide? And that led to good number of reasons as to why that has not been utilized. We did share with the IWBI, we shared with the NESL, and we did work and working with the NESL to bridge that gap in order to ensure that the NESL platform of use. I don't see that the reduction in the time in the IBC cases without being the effective use of NESL. I can, at the cost of re-emphasizing, I cannot see a transparency in the entire process without, or efficiency or efficacy of the entire process without the association of a technology platform, without integrating and interfacing with a technology platform like of that of NESL. And I'm indeed a great pleasure that IIIPI is partnering with the NESL, and we would be more than happy to participate in it. And our earnest endeavor would be that each and every IP for the services that they provide under the IBC, they use to the extent possible the NESL platform. With that, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your experiences with the participants. Our next speaker, Mr. Sudhakar Shukla, full-time member, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. Shri Shukla took charge in IBBI on 14th November 2019 and is well known to all of us. He is looking after research and regulation wing comprising corporate insolvency, corporate liquidation, individual insolvency and individual bankruptcy, research and publication, data management and dissemination and advocacy. In addition, he's also handling human resources, national insolvency and graduate insolvency programs, continuing professional education and knowledge management and partnership divisions in IBBI. So we are all eagerly waiting to listen to you. I request you to...
Thank you very much, Mr. Honorable Venkata Subbarao Hariji, Subrata Biswalji, Mr. Ashok Aldia, though he is not physically present but joining us through remote location, Dev Jyoti Ji and Rahul Madan. These are the dignitaries on dais, but I also see Bahram Vakil Sahab sitting in the audience, and we are waiting his turn to come and have a meaningful dialogue, because he has been one of the resource persons which we have always relied upon in pushing the reforms. So welcome you, sir, here. So actually, theme digitization, Azadi Ka Mahotsav, are not distinct in the sense that we are celebrating reforms in general. What happened since independence and in between and also post 14. So this, when we discuss about the digitization process and the processes under CRP and the IBC code, surely our focus is on the digitization taken out by Government of India under Digital India platform. So this was a very robust thought, in the sense that and Dr. Devjyoti has already alluded to, it facilitated like online transfers of money, direct transfers, and those are the apparent benefit you can see. But if you quantify or qualify whatever has been done during COVID time, was not possible if Digital India platform was not there. So surely we thought of it ahead of time and delivered it when it was most needed. And now actually things are being eased out. We are in position, and in Delhi we organize the gatherings and other things. But we have prepared actually webinars and online dispensation is equally effective. So that is the kind of transformation of mindset actually, that to be present in physical mode is not necessary. You can convey effectively through digital platform is the beauty of the Digital India. So this is what actually we are celebrating as major reform under Azadi Ka Mahotsav, launched by Honorable Prime Minister on 15th August. And we have a series of programs going on across India. And it would be, for us actually, it would be culminating on 11th February 2022, where we'll be having another seminar setting to reassess what we have done on the process improvements, on the reform thrust, and what is kind of unfinished agenda we have in mind when we move forward from we started IBC and everybody mentions it when there was no ecosystem worth the name. Today, actually, if you see, over 8,000 professionals, fully functional NESL, IBBI, and all the ecosystem, if you recall, a expansion of adjudicating authorities in various cities, 15 cities, it all points out towards a single purpose, that this is an important area to tackle, and we would be in position to tackle it if all the stakeholders work in tandem. With technology, it is always said, it is like art. It is soaring all the time in line with the human imagination. So as imagination moves from one level to another, technology also moves from one level to another all the time. So that is why we always say we are living in an era of disruptive technologies. Whatever you have thought yesterday may not be relevant today. And whatever we are doing today, even the PDA, I'm saying, if you are discussing today that this is a platform, if you keep it static and don't evolve with time, it will die its own death. So basically, you have to keep evolving with time, keep pace with the technology. It is security aspects all the time, yes, that has been flagged already. But cost effectiveness, actually. Haldia sahab was alluding to why this platform has, despite very promising feature, has not picked up so far. Maybe the cost effectiveness is the issue. Cost is the issue. You have to see that in times to come, you are ahead of your competitors and giving the cost effective solution to the market and the professionals. If we see the role of technology, actually, in various stages, actually, from starting to the resolution, each segment of insolvency requires active use of technology. And that is very important to note, actually, right from the entry point. We always say admission delays. Justice Hari Sahab is here. But he will vouch that admission delays is not of anybody's liking. But the kind of instruments they have to verify the default and the challenges posed by the competitors or maybe the owners, promoters, that is onerous, actually, impeding the process settlement in a quick time. So what we can do, actually, we have to think that at admission stage, cases shall not languish for that much time, 1 year or in some cases 2 years. Because we always say that value is deteriorating every day. And if you add the avoidance transaction as well, then with every delay, value deteriorates, avoidance transactions also happen. So this delay at the administration admission stage needs to be checked. And that's what we are trying. We are expanding the capacity of AA. Government has already taken several measures. This year's budget says it, that NACLT is a top priority. So they have done a bit here. But in process changes, basically, we are also contemplating that there should be some changes. We always believe as a regulator that admission, we should have a tick box approach. We are trying to see that the, what contained in that tick box should be spelled out clearly, that form is clear. And need be, if Companies Act changes are affected, why not to give the admission to a single judge or maybe technical member to see it? So those kind of reforms are needed and are on the drawing board. But how far they will go, it's a matter of deliberation and the credible input from the market. But surely this needs to be cut. And changes in code also for recognizing the admission. Because we always say NESL is struggling with the deemed default format. Many times it is challenged in AA's forum that deemed default is not to be taken as a proxy for default, as it is not explicitly provided in under the code. So we have expanded actually the definition of default to include the banker's book, which they say, so that actually that is the authenticated document with the bank, updated all the time. So if that is produced, I think that should rest the question whether default of certain amount has happened or not happened. I was discussing with Dr. Devjyoti while coming here. When you are pushing dematerialization drive on loan accounts with the banks, and many states have already allowed it, then why not banks should be insisted to have a consent from the borrower that its data, updated data, would be shared with IU and would be treated as a event of default if bank notifies so. So that is the instrument, but like it's a legal instrument, how to design, I'm not a lawyer, so we have ideas, but lawyers try to restrict the domain within the like evolving jurisprudence and natural justice. So we have to see those things, but surely we have to find some way out that default, establishment of default and entry of the process should be expedited. Second issue is during the process, actually, like claim, IM, is more or less streamlined in the sense that all forms are ready. We know that these are the forms to be filled by IP all the time in compliance. So processes, forms are to be in machine readable form. Right now, what we are getting in IBBI, they are half of the documents are machine readable, half are not. So when you are making a digital push, If it is not machine readable, somebody has to again type everything. Then you are losing much on the digital push efficiency gains, which we are intending otherwise. So that we have to, that I always request to our colleagues, IPs, that documents which you are submitting under various forms should be machine readable. Should not, because it is not only the, like you are in the credit market, you are in the distressed asset market. This is one of the purpose. Second purpose is what about the credible research? Whether we are going right, wrong. Right now, data is not in the form to have a credible research on IBBI outcomes. All the time researchers comes to us that this is a partial information which we are giving, why not the whole information? We have formed a research group which is under Dr. K.P. Krishnan, who is guiding us to build our capacity to undertake research initiatives and dissemination of information to the researchers. SBI is also part of that initiative. NESL is, and IIM Ahmedabad is. So there are lot many players which are coming in to help us to build our database on scientific lines, which requires some miles to cover, because the data format which we are getting needs to be in appropriate machine readable form. As a big reform in this big offensive, you can say, in this regard, that we have finalized the IBC 21 platform. Its RFQ is ready and it has to be floated, some teething troubles, but surely in a month or two, this IBC 21 would be notified RFQ. So market participants will come and deliver the platform, which would be again based on like machine to machine talking, we are saying API based dispensation. The moment something happens, NCLT automatically records in IBBI updates. Whatever you type as a IP in your room of comfort, it updates our record if you are connected with us. MCA records on companies. So all the gambit of it, basically AI, artificial intelligence, how to use in distressed asset market. So we are trying to do that. And it is in the realm of possibility now, as the document is already ready and roll out would take, say, 6 to 7 months. Apart from processes improvement, when you are saying disposal of stress asset, again, you need invitation of expression of interest. Large participation is always said. If it is a localized and some newspaper carried out and people have not read it, participation is not there. Initially, we said, okay, why not to have on NESL's website, IBBI website also hosts this. So this information is hosted, but still maybe due to COVID, not everything falls on technology as such, but there were reluctance on part of basically resolution applicants to chip in and come up and have a competition going in the asset market. So that is a issue which we thought can be very effectively addressed by platform of distressed asset. And today we have gathered to see the efficacy of platform of distressed asset. It is conceived to be a storehouse of all the information which IP wants to store with NESL, a secured information platform where all information A to Z is available. It also facilitates players to come in, chip in for interim finance. Right now, we have seen that interim finance is not taken seriously in the sense banks don't come forward, others don't come forward. ECB is not robust enough. So those things impede interim finance needs of the distressed assets. So maybe this platform would be very instrumental in facilitating information for interim finance, resolution, storehouse, and also auctions. From angle of transparency, people always say that there is nothing better than discovery of value through auctions. Maybe you dispute it fact. Some jurisdictions don't do it. Even UK, like I was talking to them only day before yesterday, they involuntary liquidation assets, they assign it based on their assessment of professionals, what is the value, and auction is not carried out. But we thought, and our systems have stating that we have to go for auctions, Swiss challenge, and this and that. And we have made it very clear in the PPIRP. Pre-packs, and that's what I requested Dr. Devjyoti ji, that you have to give a major thrust to PPIRP as well, because platform, their requirements are immense actually for tick size, for evaluation, for your main resolution plan, base resolution plan, and auction, Swiss challenge. So some tweaking in the platform would be required to cater to a MSME related PPIRP. So those are the disposal part of it, how you do it. Right now, if we see the website of IBBI, we have come a long way. Actually, our database is growing. Our presentation is becoming more and more user-friendly. And with IBC 21, I think we would be moving into different trajectory of data collection and information and dissemination of related data to the stakeholders. So that is upcoming. Upcoming reforms also I wanted to touch a bit. I thought coming to Mumbai and not sharing some thoughts on what is coming next, what you expect as a regulator, then it would be not appropriate, I thought. So basically, we are almost ready with the code of conduct of COC. So we wanted that all the stakeholders which are participating in the IBC processes should be regulated, and somehow COC as its status is remain unregulated so far. So there are so many judgments already challenging the wisdom of the COC or pointing that some decisions have been taken in a partisan manner. So that COC guidelines we have prepared. Once it is announced, next phase would be like how to implement it. And implementation, because IBBI somehow does not have same powers as SEBI has. So we would be requiring the help of other regulators to enforce any finding against the COC member. So that inter-regulatory dispensation, how it works, we are working on it. But guidelines would be announced soon. Second big ticket item which we are working, and we were working since very long, have been cross-border. ILC report came 2018. I think Vakil Saab was part of it. Then KP Krishnan report came in 2020. And now it is actually, we are finalizing the shape actually. Final call would be of government. But we feel that what was discussed in ILC and KP Krishnan committee could not comprehend, because that was a later development. What about the personal guarantors? Whether personal guarantors would be tagged with the cross-border or not. So that part actually we are tightening up. We are trying to see that personal guarantors are very much are part of the framework of cross-border. And this is in deviation of what decision ILC took in 2018. So that would be, again, it's a, like we see that if we are able to prepare ourselves, maybe in month or two, maybe if we are prepared, then deliberations at intergovernmental deliberation will start, and then we will take a call on that. I also want to say that there is a problem also in the code, in the sense it does not refer to enterprise group. Though Videocon group of companies decision has come, but it does not give us comfort in the sense that kind of regulation, kind of law we want to enact is not facilitated by the code. So again, Dr. K.P. Krishnan committee is examining that. It's too early to say that what shape it will take, but definitely we want a entry of enterprise group resolution firmly in the code. What is happening, you see, ABG shipyard case, if some, many of you must be knowing it. It invested something in Singapore, ABG Singapore. And from Singapore, some trust investment came, went in Cayman Island. And from Cayman Island, it went to a different British jurisdiction, and then to UAE. So these are complex corporate structures of subsidiaries. If you don't have group insolvency in place, it would be difficult to tackle these complex corporate structures which operate across the world and get the value out of it, actually. So definitely that is a thrust item to see that we are able to get the full implementation of regime, what other jurisdictions have. On voluntary liquidation, actually, we have come out with the circular only 3 days back, clarifying, and it was very surprising that under Section 178 of IT Act, they were seeking NOC, and many times NCLT was directing them to seek NOC. When under the express provision, 178 subsection 6, it is provided that for IBC that NOC is not required. But still, it was taking a year time, years and a half time, even 2 years time, we have cases pending for NOC. So we have clarified that this is not required. We are also trying to have a state-of-art information sharing platform with all the state and central agencies to see what is happening in the insolvency front, whether they should submit the dues or not is their prerogative, but they should know at least that this is happening. So that, again, a digital platform would be very handy in moving forward. So I thought I wanted to share some of the thoughts here. Thank you very much for giving me time. And once again, I wish this conference a success. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for addressing the participants and sharing your thoughts. Now, our next speaker is Honorable Shri Subha Rao, sir. Shri Rao is an Honorable Member, NCLT, and prior to this, he was Honorable Member, Debt Recovery Tribunal. I request Shri Honorable Shri Subha Rao, sir, to speak a few words, sir, please.
Respected dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to express my thanks to the organizers of today's function for inviting me as a chief guest. I would also like to express my thanks to them in not choosing me as a speaker, because I am just a judicial member, not much conversant with either business or any commerce. Since today's seminar is on the topic of digitalization in insolvency process, I would like to confine my discussion only to very few sentences as to how this digitalization is helping the NCLTs. As already spoken to by the earlier speakers, digitalization is going to be the order of the day, whether one likes it or doesn't like it. So digitalization has become a compulsory issue in almost every walk of life. Similarly, in dispensation of justice process also, the government of India is very keen in strict implementation of e-court system in all courts. And I'm sure the government of India has successfully achieved that object to the fullest extent, barring in few areas. As far as the e-court system in NCLTs is concerned, we are uploading the cause list through digital platform, case data, case management, filing of pleadings. Everything is going on digitalization. And litigants, as well as the legal practitioners, insolvency professionals, they are all able to see everything from wherever they are with the click of button. As already spoken by the earlier speakers, this conducting virtual courts, pandemic has forced all the courts to conduct courts through virtual mode, which is still continuing in most of the courts and tribunals. And I hope it would continue for coming couple of 2-3 months also, till Supreme Court and other high courts completely resume virtual hearing. In fact, most of the advocates, barring few mufsil advocates, the legal fraternity is also very comfortable with these virtual courts, since they are able to argue before two, three forums without moving from their place in different high courts, different tribunals, including Supreme Court, thereby minimizing time, energy, cost, everything. So coming to the use of information utility in disposing of matters before NCLT are concerned, no doubt IU is helping NCLTs in early disposal of cases to some extent. I have my reservation in saying to the full extent, because the data with regard to financial debts, defaults, I think may be updated to maximum extent, but I have my own reservation about the operational debts and defaults of operational debts. So unless the updation of data with regard to this both operational debts and financial debts is completely achieved, disposal of case basing on data cannot be achieved by NCLTs. I don't want to go into the delays or any other aspects, because the success of court is at two stages. One is prior to admission of the company petition, and the second is successful resolution. Successful resolution, of course, pre-admission delays can be attributed to some extent on the adjudicating authorities, but successful implementation or completion of CIRP process is totally not attributable to NCLTs. We are doing our best. We have our own constraints, which we cannot share in an open platform like this. So regarding delays, certainly is a matter of concern to all people, which requires an extensive debate and deliberation among all the stakeholders. So with these few words, I have no hesitation in saying that digitalization, like in other fields, is helping very much in dispensation of justice and completing resolution process of IBC before NCLTs also. I once again thank the organizers of this program for giving me an opportunity to speak. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for addressing all of us. Now we will move to the panel discussion, and I request all the guests of honor to take their designated seats. Thank you, everyone. So, moving ahead for the panel discussions, we have the dignitaries Shri Harshvardhan, Shri Nikhil Shah, Shri Behram Vakil, and Shri Brijendra Kumar Mishraji as our panel members. Before we move forward for panel discussion, I would like to give a brief introduction for our panel members. Shri Harshvardhan. Dr. Harshvardhan is an executive in residence at the Center for Financial Studies and an adjunct faculty at the SPGN Institute of Management and Research. Prior to this, he was a senior advisor with the management consulting firm Bain & Company for around 25 years. He has advised firms across India, North America, Europe, Southeast Asia, and Greater China on issues of strategy, operations, organization, risk management, etc. He has worked extensively on issues of corporate finance, including mergers and acquisitions, alliance structuring, and negotiations. He has also worked on valuations, review of major investment decisions for private equity and strategic investors. Dr. Harsh is actively involved in policymaking related to the financial services in India and has been a member of several committees set up by the Government of India and the Reserve Bank of India. He regularly contributes to articles in business media on important financial sector and economic issues. Our second member is Shri Behram Vakil, one of the founding partners of AZB and Partners. Behram and Vakil is amongst India's foremost restructuring infrastructure and project finance attorneys. He has been on several government constituted committees, including the Vishwanathan Committee on Bankruptcy Law Reform and Manoharan Committee on Development of Secondary Market for Corporate Loans. He played a key role in drafting of the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code. He has a LLM from Columbia University and is a member of the New York State Bar. Shri Brijendra Kumar Mishra. Shri Brijendra Kumar Mishra is a qualified insolvency professional having master's degree in business administration. He is also a certified chartered accountant and a member of ICSI. Mr. Mishra is former CMD, Cotton Corporation of India, and has a vast experience in restructuring and turnaround. He is also an industry expert in textiles, engineering, and sugar industry. Mr. Nikhil Shah. Nikhil Shah leads the turnaround and restructuring and the corporate finance practices of Alvarez & Marshall in India. He has significant experience advising and managing large companies through financial and operational turnarounds across the industries, including advising on the resolution of ILF and FS Group, as well as the insolvency resolution process of SRST. He has been actively involved in the policy ecosystem of IBC. He advised the Bankruptcy Law Reforms Committee, Insolvency Law Committee, the IBBI, and the Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Corporate Affairs on public policy matters pertaining to strengthening of the bankruptcy laws in India. Before we commence the panel discussion, we would like to advise that the empanelment of service providers for Platform for Distressed Assets has been done by the IBBI to ensure that the stakeholders have an access to an online marketplace that is secure and in compliance with law. This would therefore help in improving the efficiency of the process. We'll now play an audiovisual on the NESL's Platform for Distressed Assets. So lights.
The Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code is a landmark piece of legislation which marks a paradigm shift in the reorganization and insolvency resolution of corporate persons, partnership firms, and individuals. The Platform for Distressed Assets, or PDA, is an effort to further the objectives of the code by providing for an electronic marketplace which would reduce cost, improve efficiencies, and provide improved access to all market participants. The success of the resolution process requires that a market mechanism is used to arrive at a resolution plan. The PDA services are designed to facilitate this process. The disruption brought by the recent COVID-19 pandemic has brought to the fore the importance of an online marketplace. The empanelment of NESL by IBBI as a PDA service provider has been done to ensure that stakeholders have access to such a facility that is secure and is in compliance with law. National E-Governance Services Limited, or NESL, has been empaneled as India's first platform for distressed assets. The NESL's PDA services are designed to provide four critical services which are part of the corporate insolvency resolution and liquidation processes. These are Marketplace for Interim Finance, Virtual Data Room for inviting expression of interest for resolution plans or liquidation, Invitation and Evaluation of Resolution Plans, and Auction During Liquidation. The benefits of using the Platform for Distressed Assets are as under. It helps IPs in achieving insolvency resolution within the timeline prescribed. It is totally digital and accordingly accessible from anywhere in the world. It facilitates transparency and security, which will increase confidence in the insolvency and bankruptcy ecosystem. It ensures wider reach and therefore better price discovery, reduces cost of the processes, increases size of the market. NESL celebrates the launch of the Platform for Distressed Assets. Register today.
Thank you. I now request Shri Harshwardhan, Shri Nikhil Shah, Shri Behram Vakil, and Shri Bijendra Kumar Mishra to kindly join the panel and take seat on the dais. So. Please put your hands together to welcome our esteemed panel members. I now request Ms. Anjali Sharma, Head Legal and Regulatory Affairs, NESL, to moderate the discussion.
Hi. Let's do a quick mic check before we start. Okay, so thank you everyone for being here. I think Nikhil, Harsh, Bairam, Mr. Mishra, thank you. Saturday afternoon, all our other dignitaries. I think it's a pleasure. After 2 years, it's a pleasure to see people in person. I think we've had a sort of difficult time of staring at screens and seeing faces of people only on screens. Correct. This is the special hour between 3 and 5 when sleep waves come over you. Yeah. And thank you to all the 250 participants who have logged into the system and are viewing this. So while the physical audience looks small, there is a large audience who's hearing you. So thank all of you. There were a set of questions that I had circulated to all of you just to think about the discussion. And the way we will do this panel is maybe in the first question, I'll seek your initial comments about what you think the state of digitization/digitalization is in the insolvency ecosystem, and what your views are on why that state exists right now. And that will be a good baseline point for us to begin our conversation on what can be done going forward. So the reason why this question is important is because I think there is a great push in the private sector as well as in the public sector all across to think about both digitization and digitalization. And I think the two are different. And there is a need to understand that. So digitization is often sort of thought of in the context of records or information or, documents, whereas digitalization means something totally different. It thinks about process, incentives for adoption, and how things can be done in a manner that uses technology effectively. So starting from left to right, if each of you could take a couple of minutes and give us your views about how far has the IBC process been aided by either digitization or digitalization? And what, as per you, has been the experience of participants if this has taken place? And if it hasn't, then what? Why do you think it's so? So Nikhil, if we could have your initial remarks. Thanks.
Thank NESL for inviting me to participate on this panel, and congratulations on the launch of the platform of distress assets. I've had the pleasure of actually using the system before it launched, and I found it to be quite useful.
I'll restart in case nobody heard me. Firstly, thank you NESL for inviting me to participate on this panel today. It's a pleasure, and congratulations on the launch of the platform for distressed assets. I have had the pleasure of using the system before it launched, and I found it to be very useful, and I hope that they are able to achieve their objectives with the launch of that platform. Thank you, Anjali, for the question. I think that it is a very important question, actually. Given what's happened with the rest of the world during the pandemic, we had a crisis where we all had to stay at home, although some people didn't consider that a crisis to stay at home. But it certainly pushed us very forward in terms of having to use communication and digital tools in order to be in touch with colleagues, clients, family, which was not the case. While the technology existed, wasn't heavily used in the way that it is today. And so I think what has become abundantly clear to everybody, I would say, is that the benefits of using technology and digital tools is immense. Not only in terms of efficiency improvements, and which reduce the time and cost of doing any activity or process, but also to help build knowledge capacity in terms of previous learnings that have taken place, and specifically within on the IBC, all of the precedent judgments that have taken place, which would make it much easier to guide participants in terms of what actions to take, going forward. And when I mean participants, I mean everybody from the adjudicating authority, the judges, the technical members, to insolvency professionals, advisors like ourselves, lawyers, everybody can gain from using better knowledge management. And this is, you know, can be widely available, but isn't actually in place at present in the way it should be. And lastly, I would say that it really helps in increasing the credibility of using the system for resolution or liquidation, finding an outcome. Because if you have a digital system that people are using, it can really provide a much shorter time in order to get to an outcome. And currently, in my view, that is the biggest issue, that the biggest challenge that the CRP process and IBC is facing in today's environment. I feel that all of the participants haven't been using the tools that are available widely. It's something that requires a push, because it's a change. Nobody, you know, most people on their own don't gravitate towards change easily. And so we need to create the right incentives in order to force people to actually use the system. And once they start using the system, they quickly find out that it's much better than what was the case physically. And just give you, you know, one example. I think that even in the budget, there has been a large push in terms of doing digital hearings for insolvency cases. I have to say that, you know, it hasn't worked out as well as envisioned. But if we were to actually push that system with the adequate number of bench members, for instance, it can reduce the amount of time required for any case. Because if you just think about it, in a physical hearing, there would have to be participants from the insolvency professional, from the corporate debtor, from COC, key COC members, and all of their legal advisors and counsel that would have to show up to a particular hearing at a particular time. That time is never actually adhered to. And so typically the entire day will go in that entire process, which is a huge amount of time and cost for everybody to show up and wait, compared to having a digital hearing that is at a specific time and everybody just logs in to the system. You can imagine it might just take half an hour or 1 hour for that matter to be heard and concluded, actually. So there is, in my view, massive benefits if we were to focus on this. And I'm happy to say a lot of the tools exist already. And I think the NESCL has done, in my view, a much better job than I envisioned to begin with when this was being discussed at the BLRC, the Bankruptcy Law Reform Committee. And so it's something that I think everybody needs to focus on from the regulators to the judiciary to the market participants in terms of using this in a much better fashion. Thank you.
So Harsh, I'll nuance the question a little for you, because I think you're not a direct participant in the insolvency ecosystem. But you do see, I mean, I would say that the financial sector is perhaps one of the most digitally advanced sectors in the country as of now, right? So there is this genuine feel and about the financial sector ecosystem, about how technology benefits everyone. And yet the same set of participants, when they walk into the insolvency space, actually show, as Nikhil is pointing out, resistance to adopting digital tools. And why do you think that is?
Yeah, so part of it is just, I guess, so I'll take forward what Nikhil said, which is digitalization, which is the use of technology in processes primarily. And I think that's where, if you are a banker, but you are along with other participants who are not so digital, then you are forced to actually adopt to whatever process they are adopting. So I think what happened in COVID, actually, if it carries forward and we start using more and more technology in our normal processes of NCLT and so on. I mean, I remember old days of DRT, you go to Chennai, you get listed for some time in the afternoon and hearing never comes up and you have to fly back. I've known my friends who had to do that several times. But I want to also focus on digitization, which is the whole information side, because from a lender's point of view, I think it's not just the role of bankruptcy in resolving distress, but over a period of time, it has to inform credit processes. It has to factor in the outcome of bankruptcy, has to factor in the way I make credit decisions. I mean, a simple example is that if you want to move to an expected loss basis of provisioning, unlike what we have today, which is exposed kind of, then you would know the recovery, want to know the recovery rates across different types of securities. Now, if NCLT orders are machine readable, or at least are standardized templates where for every resolution you give, actually, this was the recovery for this type of lender with this type of security. That would enormously help lenders. I tried doing that for somebody, and every order basically is on its own. You have to read it actually to understand. And many times, this information is not simply captured. So, for example, if X amount of haircut was taken by a particular lender, I want to know what security that lender had so that I can have some recovery rates worked out. So, we get this overall sense of recovery rate of 31% thereabout. But that's not useful for me as a lender. I want to have much more nuanced understanding of recovery rates across different security types. So, those are the kind of things I think digitization can greatly help. So, if we can start with simply standardizing the order templates or resolution plans and putting out information in a machine readable form, I think Mr. Shukla also referred to that. I think those could be great steps towards helping lenders improve their own credit process as they go along.
Sure. And I think we have discussed this before. I think this is an opportunity for us to understand the true value of collateral.
Absolutely.
When it goes into an enforcement mechanism. Behram, I mean, what is your perspective? And I think you have seen all sides of the IBC process, the policy side, the sort of the participant side. I think you represented all types of participants in the insolvency process. So what do you see as the sort of the incentive structure or the change that's needed in the incentive structure for greater tech adoption to aid the process?
Thanks a lot. So thank you very much to NESL for this opportunity and to all of you for being there, and Shuklaji for your very kind and generous words. And I think, at the outset, I would echo what Nikhil said, that there's a great opportunity for NCLT and IBC to kind of lead the way in this, because unfortunately, I'll be very frank, being being part of the legal community for close to 40 years now, that we are really far behind. And Harsh, in a way, I get what you're saying totally, but I think the digitization is far ahead of. If I step back, in most parts of the world, there is what they call case management. So on the first day in a UK court, the lawyer will tell you, so that it's very good for you as well to know, that this is, all the pleadings will be filed on this day, this day, this day, the reply, affidavits, et cetera, et cetera. For each hearing, I'll need 1 hour, for this I'll need 15 minutes. So when you go into a court there, the first time I went, 25 years ago, I was shocked. The courtroom is empty because only the parties who have the hearing are there, because they are not going to take up any other case. So this is 25 years ago, and we are one of the world's leading countries in technology. So, I've discussed this now with so many of the decision makers. You may remember, even when we were doing IBC, and given that our finance minister at that time was one of our leading legal luminaries, I talked about the UK system and said, why can we not change this so that all the administrative process is run by a government entity, of course, for security and confidentiality reasons. But there is no administrative judge. As it is, there's a bandwidth issue and you're wasting one judge just on administrative matters. So we tried very hard, but somehow judicial reform is still something that we have to aspire to. So the technology and the digitization, it would be fantastic to have the formats you're talking about, but frankly, to tell a judge anywhere in the world that you fill this up in a format, I think that's a big ask. So I think that will have to be done by whether it's researchers or some other body who will have to extract from the judgment or the order what you need and put it into a form. I think that will be the solution. But I definitely think that the time has more than come where we have case management. And if NCLT and NCLAT can take a lead role and in some way show the rest of the Indian judiciary that this can be done? I mean, once again, in the finance space, as I'm certainly not an expert, all of you know much better about it, where, say, SBI has taken technology with their super app, or where the Jam Trinity has taken India. Today, the Fed looks at our Aadhaar usage or, you know, our payment technologies. So similarly, I think really people always said until COVID that, okay, the equity markets can be done digitally and technology, but debt markets don't lend themselves to this. Once COVID happened, everyone did it that way. Can a capital markets roadshow happen digitally? No chance. You have to fly all over the world. Today, what happened? It's gone. Everything is done and the capital markets are booming and it's all done digitally. So I think the same way, at least let's start with the Singapore experience. I would say, of course, the regulations and rules will need amendment, but let's go with the procedural hearings. Let those at least be digital. I understand some of the substantive hearings, it is very difficult because there are nuances, there's body language, I'm speaking to you face to face. But the procedural hearings, definitely there's huge efficiency. I think once again, you know, there is a huge cost factor. You know, my colleagues are a big part of that. As Nikhil said, to fly a senior counsel, we know what senior counsel anyway charge. So you will reduce costs for the clients and for the system dramatically through digitization. So I really believe let's start, at least make a beginning so that some of the learnings we have been forced to have over the last 22 months, we actually make those learnings permanent.
Thank you.
So Mr. Mishra, I mean, just extending this question in the sort of matters that you have dealt with, what has been your understanding on the kind of sort of issues that the RP or the other participants are facing, and why is it that they are slow to see technology as a solution to some of those issues? So okay. Just
thank you. First of all, I thank NESL for inviting me on this occasion, and I thought to the all dignitaries sitting before me and who shared their valuable views. And I have been enriched with that. And I thank our panelist also. So coming to this, in my opinion, this word digitization is 12 or 13 year old, which I have seen in my earlier company where I worked with as a director of finance there. So digitization of documents, which now NESL, I have been myself using that platform for digitizing all the data of one of my corporate data, which I just said. Next case also, I will do that. So far as IBC benefit is there, certainly from day one, like from getting the valuation done of the properties, in case the data which we find will be digitized, certainly I will take the efficient information from them to pass on to the valuer so that he can value it well. And thereafter also, after at the time of preparing information memorandum, there is a lot of data which we use to make. In case we find the data from CD in that form, certainly we'll be able to give a better perception of the company to our corporate debtor through the digitization applicant. But normally, particularly in the field of insolvency, what I have seen till now, the corporate debtor to whom we are dealing with, in all state bank or any other public sector or in any other company which is a listed one or not listed one, all these data are in digitized form. After even that Y2K problem we have been dealing with since then, I think any company, private limited or public limited or any big company or government one, may be having their accounting system on only through the software, maybe ready-made or tailor-made or whatever it. But in case of insolvency, the company, some of the companies, yes, certainly I have came across with the companies which have all the data, most of the data digitized, even the fixed asset register, which I have gone through, which is the most complicated register. Most of the companies may not be having initially from the day one, who has been historically 10 or 20 year old. But at the same time, in another company, the corporate debtor means digitization is a resolution which every person who is doing something skeptical may not be ready to use it. So in one company, I have found it, even then the company was under admitted for insolvency. But in rest, yes, they are skeptical to provide data, which we have to anyway dig it. And I think NCSL, NESL is the platform. From today onwards, we can do so. In past, certainly, nobody can be blamed because it was a fait accompli. And nobody can create the data which physically or this on software form. But from today onwards, I think NESL is a platform which can be extended to other spheres of the business and corporate world. Because data which I have listened the word digitization 2008 because I was director of finance in NTC and they have all the assets across the world. And they have sold assets. And it was first time when we do e-auction of the sale, e-sale of the properties. So that we have been implementing. Government is very much keen to implement, as per my perception, to introduce digitization of data since long. But we means all genuine persons, certainly in my opinion, will go for that. Because it is every way beneficial, time saving, cost saving, space saving. But in insolvency, I am due to reluctance for one reason or other. I have came across with some of the corporate data. Yes, they are ready to do in some of the case where they are even banks, etc. also who have lent money to them are unable to extract data from them. I think it is only intentional one, and time is for digitization. And if we'll go ahead, certainly all the companies and entire the corporate world will have to be digitized.
Okay, so let me, with this set of introductory remarks, come to more specific questions. So some of you on this table were part of the initial BLRC deliberations. You had come and advised the BLRC, and even then we were all aware that the IU is a unique experiment. Right. It has no global parallel, and we didn't know how it would pan out even then. And yet, I think the BLRC took a very bold step of sort of proposing an IU and saying that, look, we need an information system to support the insolvency ecosystem. Now, of course, it takes time to build a repository, and that time has passed. And but now, I think increasingly, some of you already know this, the quantum of information that's stored with the IU has come up to a certain threshold, right? In respect, particularly of corporate debtors. And the challenge, however, is that some of the processes in the insolvency ecosystem have moved forward manually. And people have become used to the manual functioning of the process. So for instance, the IU process was meant to support claim filing, initial admission of cases, adjudication by the RP of some of the claims being filed, whether this is correct or not, and so on and so forth, right? And yet, I think most of these processes today are being conducted manually, and there appears to be this hesitation to sort of use the IU platform more effectively. Now, given all this, what do we do to ensure that the system comes back on track in terms of the thinking that the BLRC had done? And, you know, I would again start with Nikhil, and perhaps we can, go in a different order. So Nikhil, Bairam, Mr. Mishra, and lastly, Harsh.
So I just want to maybe augment some of the things that I think that can be digitized or are in place already that aren't being used effectively. One is, in my mind, the admission of a case can be an automatic process. Actually, I do not think that it requires any hearings at all. If it's done through in the NESL or an information utility where you have a commercial bank that has met all. That's very clear as what the criteria for admission is. I don't think that requires any adjudication, actually, in my opinion.
In fact, there's a process for issuing a record of default, and as you know, right?
That's right. Some of the things like Bairam talked about in terms of having an intelligent case management system that can be put in place. This doesn't exist right now, but can easily be put in place, actually. A database of legal precedents that have been taken place. Again, we have the orders that are there, but that database is not a very intelligent database, actually, and can be used in a much more advanced way to actually enhance learning and knowledge amongst the participants. I know, Bahram, you were saying that the judges may not want to use a template when they come out with orders, and I can appreciate why you're saying that, but I think that we can have a format, not a template, but a format that is machine readable, right? That can be easily then used by others subsequently. You don't need to dictate what that looks like, but just the, whether it's a document, PDF, etc., that can be read easily as such. That I think we can manage to get in place. And then some of the, creating some of the infrastructure capabilities in order to enhance research. As well. I think that Mr. Sudhakar mentioned that there's some work going on right now in terms of creating a wing of the IBBI to enhance that research capability. I think that would be very much desired and useful in terms of the context of what we're trying to achieve with the IBC. And so I think that there are many many of these initiatives that are in place or are ongoing. I think what's really required actually is a major both carrot and stick approach that needs to be put in place. There needs to be some stuff that is mandatory, okay, where there's no possibility of doing that in a physical way. Actually, as soon as you do that, everyone is forced to have to actually do it digitally. And then what quickly happens is that they realize it's much easier actually. And much more efficient to do it in that manner. And so a lot of these things just require either the NCLT or the registry or other with the gatekeepers of that process to just take a stand. And that stand in today's environment should be relatively easy to take, actually, in my view. The second is that you need to also have some incentives in place as well, that people see the benefit of actually doing it in this way. Because changing human behavior is always, an uphill battle unless they see that there's something in it for them as well. And so I think this mix of using both the carrot and stick should drive behavior towards better using digital tools that can improve the entire process for everyone.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think that, take it step at a time. So I think that maybe we can flip it and it'll be one of those novel situations where the panel asks members of the audience a question. But we were saying that in terms of one of the primary purposes, as Anjali says, when we were drafting the IBC, IU was definitely a novel concept. As far as we know, it was not anywhere else in the world. And it has several very good functions, including, as we talked about, claim, etc. But one of the most critical parts of it was the admission process, so that you avoid the delay in admissions. And if we look at the history right in the beginning, the admissions were quite close to the target goal. I mean, a couple of months. And one of the things that has slipped very badly is the admissions. I think it's now usually more than a year. So this is something that is really hurting the process. So, sir, I know you mentioned that for the OCs, so let us leave OCs aside, because yes, that is definitely more complicated. It was always envisioned that it will be easier for financial creditors. Because for financial creditors, the way it was designed was there was an acknowledgement process also. So that should, as Nikhil say, be absolutely sacrosanct and legal evidence. So I think that 2 points I wanted to make. One is that for the admission process, we really need to find a digital and IU solution, which reduces the time. And second thing, I'm saying, because Nikhil touched upon it, I guess the AI for precedence is lawyers. and they charge a good amount of fees for that. So all the precedents are there put before NCLT and NCLAT. So the problem here, and I understand the practical problem, is I think in many ways, with all due respect, because of the seniority and the standing of the senior counsel that appear before you, there is too much patience. If there is a clear-cut precedence right from Supreme Court, then I've seen even, you know, Mr. Fali Nariman, the most famous lawyers, Supreme Court on admission, they give you few minutes. Say, sometimes, Mr. Nariman, you have to understand you have a very weak case. Next. And they, you know that well, they flip the file and you go to the next. To allow a 2-3 day argument on something that the Supreme Court has already ruled upon, I think this again leads to delays. Of course, the lawyer is at fault for going on and on, but he's being paid to do that. That's his job. So it is that you have to be a little more impatient firmly. I think that that's... and the other third thing I wanted to say, and I don't say it because Shuklaji is here, but, you know, dealing with international lawyers in some of these cases, which are cross-border, we talked about this group issue. In fact, if it was there in Shrey, it would really help us because this is going to be a big issue. But even the international lawyers and people we talk about, the wealth of knowledge that is already sitting on the website there, if someone, as Nikhil said, people are not using all the information that is already there. It, I mean, they were blown away by the amount of stuff that is already available, real time, and the details that are there. Now, with your new platform, of course, that you have launched, it's fantastic.
So, Mr. Shukla, what sort of is today is the sort of prevents RPs from, or even people who are seeking to file petitions from using the ROD to go forward, or for instance, use the IU records to look at claims that are coming in and to figure out whether the claim process can work more efficiently?
I think no, there is no reason for not contacting and not availing the services of IU by the resolution professional. Particularly, we are talking about the financial claim. I think it is the one only condition wherein financial claim, this claim from financial creditor has to be made through electronic mode. That is the compulsory. Whereas in other cases, it was not mandatory. For operational creditor and other creditors, it was not mandatory. So that type of condition, I think, in case of RP, as per my perception, it is easier for RP, IRP or liquidator to contact IU and avail the services. Because in that case, as everybody knows, that data, which is, we can save the time, we can save the money, we can save the space. And in the circumstances, when IBC, as per my perception, time is the essence of the IBC. And it is the time. If you lose it, then you can lose the money, you can lose the integrity, you can lose the space, everything you can have to bear with. So, only thing which I think, in case of NESL, and one more thing which I wanted to know, wanted to say, that when I was going through the IBC code initially, days, initial days when it was likely to be implemented, initial days, I think admission of the cases were not that much later. Subsequently, after 2018 or so, it was 1 year or more than the time it has taken. And when, as what I think that when law was made, then this getting case admitted, getting the default diagnosed was a stopgap arrangement, and IU was the compulsory. In case IU will become effective, then all these delay in admission will be ruled out, as per my perception. Because one has to contact the IBC, there the need of all these hearings, advocates, etc., will not be there, because one window shop will have, one window arrangement will be there, and any judiciary system can verify it directly. So that is the, though it was also challenged initially, that at the same time when we are introducing a law, how can we can get that establishment effective from the day one? That was not possible. So that's why those arrangements were made. But I think NESL, particularly for default and record,
I don't know. By now, I think the courts on law cannot make it compulsory for because since 4 years and 5 years has been passed. So for default, coming to the court, companies, I don't find any company which may not be having their data online through Kelly or any other software. So this should be immediately provided. And by now, with the e-courts, I am of the perception that all the judiciary system has been developed in the form when they are giving VC hearing and passing the order, uploading the order on the website on the day or two, then certainly they can also interact with the data with the corporate world in the form of default and ledgers, etc. So that immediately, and IU may be most beneficial and most, I think, contributory in this regard. So that has to be made effective by the lawmakers, in my opinion.
Harsh, I'll come back to you with, again, you know, I'll ask you more pointed questions, not specific to the insolvency domain, but, you know, information repositories are normal in the financial sector, right? You have the CICs, you have CRILSI, and now there's the IU. I mean, the structure, the reporting requirements, etc., may differ a little bit, but fundamentally the design and the idea is the same. Now, given that the IU, in fact, was always thought of as equivalent to a public registry of credit information, whereas the others, the CIC, CRILSI, etc., have sort of constraints on access and how information can be used, etc. Now, what will it take for the financial sector to stop viewing IU as a compliance burden and to use it effectively and think about how they give credit, how they monitor credit? What will it take?
Yeah, I guess it, as is with all other issues in financial sector, there have to be enough incentives. And I think the manner in which incentive for that will come is that they start seeing direct benefits of doing that. So if they believe that their own situations in their own insolvency cases should improve if they start using IU or start contributing data. I think that's the only way you can make it mandatory and things like that. But you know, then it gets clearly treated as a compliance burden. The my general sense though is that, you know, as Mr. Vakil said sometime earlier, that, you know, if you don't have the whole case process digitized, then one element of it being digital does not really help, because then there is a sort of general culture of using manual process, and that happens a lot, I feel, in case of insolvency cases. Remember, in cases of banks, even now, I mean, these are not the most glamorous parts of the banker's life, you know, dealing with insolvency. And so, if the whole ecosystem working manually, then I mean, they sort of become the part of the process. So I think one, we have to think about how do we create the right incentive for them to actually start using electronic data and using IUs and so on. And then the other bit is that if you just digitize the whole NCLT process, then they will start using it, because then just one element of it does not stand out.
But actually, very easy answer. If, as you said, it's an incentive that the banks see that by doing this, in 30 days, all their cases get admitted, exactly. Of course, they're going to do it. Then they'll say, this is fantastic. Who wants to wait for 1 year?
Exactly.
So the whole thing is, it should at least for financial creditors
Absolutely.
Work the way we were hoping it would work, where it's just very quick and very smooth.
So that's where if the process ensures that all the filings using the IU data makes the admission faster, then obviously there'll be enough incentive. Because as you said that, you know, every day saved is a value saved. Yeah.
So that link needs to come alive, basically. Okay. So I with that, yeah, go ahead.
Just to respond to that point, actually, I think the NCLT in 2020 actually came out with an order saying that it was mandatory that there needed to be a record of default from an IU for admission of a case. Unfortunately, there was an appeal in the Calcutta High Court and which struck down that order, actually, which indicated to me, at least, that perhaps either there needs to be appealed or more closely, there needs to be a legislative change, actually, that actually does mandate that to be the case.
So thank you for saying that, because that was my next question, is that
much of the structure of the IBC right now actually allows for a either or of digital and physical. And I think some of it was done consciously because the digital ecosystem was not as prepared at the start of IBC as it is today, perhaps. And the key question is that given that the either or model is currently baked into the law, is there a need? And given that IBC amendments are being considered even now and going forward, I think it's one of the laws where legislative changes have happened when needed. One of the questions is that should a more stringent view be taken within the legal framework itself on how technology is to be deployed? But the counter of that, and I want to pose this as a question, is that do you think that it is something that will not stand scrutiny of the judicial system? Because people will say, by mandating some of this, you are in fact excluding some sets of people who may not be comfortable or may not be using the system. So how does one get around this? Do you think that it's time to consider a legislative change? And will that stand scrutiny? And
that's more no, so I think...
Behram's on the ILC, so he can take this forward, actually.
No, I think definitely. I think your point is very well taken that, you know, in this 5 years, as we said, in 2 years, we've made 5 years progress on digitization and the banks are at the forefront. So I think anyone regulated by RBI, so pretty much all the FCs, for them, it should be mandatory. And I think it would meet judicial scrutiny, frankly, all the way from NCLT, NCLAT, Supreme Court, you've seen that on commercial or banking matters, they very rarely interfere. So I think we should definitely go down that road. And then you will also get what you said, the incentivization will come through because then immediately you will have those fast admissions. If you remember our deliberations, for OCs, it's much more difficult. Imagine employee. So employee, you know, on day one, he says, yes, Nikhil's junior comes and says, Nikhil, sign up that you owe me so much every month. Nikhil will say, go to KPMG for a job. So that leverage part was very difficult in some cases. And that's why we said for OCs, again, same for a supplier. If you're a very major supplier, you can get it done. If you're a small supplier to Tata Steel, again, there'll be dadagiri. So there it was tough, but for FCs, I think it's a no-brainer.
So you feel it's time for a legal change?
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm less optimistic about a legal enforcement of a process to be held through the judiciary. I mean, it will be challenged and it will be struck down and so on because there are issues about small creditors and all will come up and you know how do you protect them and so on. So my own view is that if the process ensures that the it moves faster, more efficiently, if you're using IU, that itself will be without having to sort of clamp down legally and making it mandatory. I honestly don't know that it will survive because our history of mandating a certain process through law has, I mean, there are many probably other examples. Mr. Vakil will know 100 more than I would of them being struck down on various grounds. So I don't know how.
It can be ensured by bringing necessary amendment to evidence. That's
a very tall order, yeah.
It is a conclusive proof of evidence. It can be done.
Nikhil, you think it's time for a legal change?
The very whole aspect of prescribing 14 days period for business.
Exactly.
I think we have some people that are very directly involved in being able to opine on this versus myself. But I'm very happy to hear that it can and should be done. Yes.
So you think it's time for a legal change?
Absolutely.
Okay, Mr. Mishra.
I have just seen. I came across that Sarsai. It is a when a. No, sir. Sarsai has been corporatized by all the financial creditors over a period of 2 years or three. And it is a centralized registry system wherein all the title deeds has to be deposited there. So when, as per my perception, in a similar way, following the same path, all this for information utility also, maybe one or two, there should be a system and it should be made mandatory as per my perception. And with the whatever Subbarao Saab told, and like that by making evidence act or so, anything. So that all these, because this is in case of judiciary, till the date of admission, at least we can save the time. Thereafter, okay, let the law take its own course. But by that, I think, if we used to do, and it may be law can be accordingly modified or changed, like why we did so for financial creditors, why not for operational creditors? Similarly, particularly for big creditors, suppose a claim is to be filed against listed companies. All the state companies or all big companies, like all this, this our corporate governance law, we should make mandatory for those big ones. For a smaller one, yes. Like 1 lakh limit has been increased to 1 crore. So in similar way, information utility services 4 years has passed. And in case we are not able to buy now or in the next 2-3 years, certainly, sorry to say, like time will not, means this 14 days, all this timeline will become ridiculous.
No, not right. Behram is ready for questions, but I am not. Okay. So, couple of questions from me. Sorry, Behram, bear with me. And then we'll open it for Q&A. So, you know, you saw the wonderful AV which was presented on the platform for distressed assets, right? And at some level, the whole idea is to completely digitalize the workflow of CIRP. And you see IBBI's sort of regulation already aids that. A lot of the forms are very well described. The information to be collected is well laid out. IBBI, in fact, has thought this through quite well. They have empaneled vendors. I think they are thinking along the curve for much of this. And yet, you know, we are in the early stages of adoption of some of these methods. What in the IP incentive structure can drive this? So is it that today the fee structure for IPs or the sort of the financial incentives don't support use of technology or systems? Or is it just, as you keep saying, sheer human
inertia? I don't think so. Actually, if the IBBI mandates that it's done in a certain way, all of the IPs will follow like almost immediately, because everybody is concerned about disciplinary action
I think in a lighter vein, what you've said, you've hit the nail on the head. That like for liquidator, you've got that reverse. The faster you do it, the higher you... I think for IP lawyers, everyone in the... All the advisors make it that same incentive.
We have it in record that Behram is willing to adjust lawyers' fees for quicker resolution. Yes?
I mean, because as you said, time is of essence. Yeah. All the economy showed us that it's all about time.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, I sort of agree with Harsh that making anything mandatory comes with its own issues and challenges and often doesn't stand to scrutiny by courts, because courts then say there are a set of people who will get excluded, and perhaps that is right. But is there anything in the incentive system? And this is sort of a question for all of you who may want to answer it. What can be done to in the IP incentives? So is it that there are a set of large IPs who will be very happy using systems like this because they see the efficiency? But there are a whole range of small cases and small IRPs who are not, where the adoption is likely to be much smaller. Their incentive structures are very different from the larger, more organized IRPs. And so what are your views on this?
So I don't think that firstly it needs to be exclusionary to any particular stakeholder. I think it should be offered to everybody if they meet the criteria of what is laid out in the law already. I just think that it's much easier for larger institutions like banks and other financial lender creditors to have that system in place, actually, in order to meet the criteria much more quickly, actually, because it's much more clear cut. But that should be offered to operational creditors, to employees as well, or any other creditors that might be there that can avail of the system. If they are able to comply, in some cases they are, like for example, if the Behram gave of a large supplier can use its muscle to actually get that in place. And they should be able to avail of the system just like a financial creditor would be. And so I think that making it mandatory isn't necessarily a bad thing, actually, as long as it's done in a fair and transparent manner for all parties to access that. And I do really believe that that time has arrived, because if, you know, in my experiences, it's actually longer than 1 year for admission. I'm sitting on a bunch of cases that are like 2-3 years right now, pending admission. In fact, Mr. Vishwas and I were discussing one case in particular that has taken about 2+ years actually to get to the admission stage. And it really came down to the judge getting fed up, actually. And he said, I'm not willing to hear this matter anymore, and I need to admit it. You have no grounds not to have the case admitted. And so, but imagine it took 2 years for him to say that, you know. And the delay is it causes people to not want to use the system. They think that it's better to find an alternative, right? And often that alternative is them taking a lower value of recovery, right? Because they don't have the muscle to actually enforce something, and they have to then take terms from the borrower or other parties that are involved in order to facilitate some kind of resolution out of court. And I really feel that that is very unfair for creditors that have actually lent money, you know, that in that situation.
You're absolutely right. I think that the, you know, that's why I said this admission part is a big issue. If we can save that 1 or 2 years, that's huge, and bring it back to what was contemplated was 15 days. Even if we take a month, that's very fair. And sorry, I mean, the other thing I did think, I think technology can help a lot with, and we just saw it with Divan, it started with Binani, is the bidding process. There have been a lot of complaints again that it's not fair. And Harsh will certainly have a view on this. And there again, you know, like we have in the pre-pack regime, where we've used the Swiss challenge and 48-hour window, and that's it. It closes after that. And finally, in Divan, that's what we had to do. So all the qualitative aspects, first there were all these arguments that it's not just quantitative. You know how the economists are. So it's also qualitative. So you do all the qualitative part. You've given all your points for that. And then when it's just about the money, I think we should follow the pre-pack process. Have a 48-hour just window open, transparent, and close it. Otherwise, too often there have been bidders who feel rigged. You're hitting a six after the 20th over. In a 20th over match, how do you hit a six after the 20th over? So this kind of stuff, I think that's, again, I think easy technology fix.
On incentive part, since it is an IP process, so I think I am the right person to reply. As per my perception, this in case of liquidation process, we have already made in the act. And in case of resolution process, but as per my perception, there should not be any regulation from the means the government side or lawmaker side. It should leave it on the means open from the banks. Though in some cases, banks like particularly for liquidation, the rate of fees, etc. has been given. But even then, bank has been negotiating, and we have been offering less than that even. So that should be left with the stakeholders, and law should not, regulator should not intervene in that. Because anyway, in case they will do so, similar to liquidation, the same thing may like to happen. Apprehensions are there. So let it be there on that. Thank you.
Harsh, you want to? No? Okay. I can see. Okay, and I think just one final question, and this is more sort of not just thinking about the IU or the PDA platform that we are offering, but generally thinking about the wider world of digital initiatives which affect firms, right? So we know that MCA 21 has existed for many years. It's the largest e-filing system. Companies are now able to file almost all of their requirement of compliances through the MCA 21 system. There's the income tax portal, which is coming up with all its challenges. I think at the end, it is likely to be an extremely sophisticated system. There's the GST network. There's CERSAI, we know as a security information registry. So I'll only talk about the public registries, Nikhil. Nikhil, see.
RBI. NBS registration is not online.
That's right. And given that so much of information about firms is available in the public domain, and these are all public digital infrastructure initiatives, ideally, the whole process of information gathering for insolvency, and with the IU, of course, right? The process of information gathering for insolvency proceedings should become simpler. And yet, we find that these systems seem to be operating in silos and are not always coming together in a natural sort of cohesive way in the insolvency process. And why do you think? Is it a legal hurdle? Is it process issues? Is it the tough problems of departments? What do you think stands in the way of a more cohesive information system emerging? And again,
But Anjali, this is a question for yourself, actually, right? Because working at the NESL, you should let us know why you haven't been able to get access to MCA21 or the GST or income tax databases, because we as the users of the system would really like that, actually, if you had that information-rich repository of information. So what's the problem?
I'll give the answer once Behram gives the answer. I'll give you an answer.
No, please go ahead. Please.
No, I think your question had the answer that there is, there are technological issues that they are all different kinds of systems. And secondly, there is a turf issue that, you know, these institutions either want to protect or don't see any incentive in actually collaborating with somebody else. So it's a combination of that, that it does not all come together. But as Nikhil says, you are the ones who have to bring it all together.
Yeah, certainly not a legal question.
Okay. No, since everybody has pushed it to me, I'll wait for Mr. Mishra to be my support. But what are your views, sir?
Whatever I think for particularly this... I observe that we have a system, means NCLTs most of the time used to ask the RP that you have to submit a progress report monthly or so. And IBBII, thanks RBBII, Shukla Sahib is there for being more interactive with the RPs and fraternity and this developing the system of filing the form, various forms. So with that, at least they are in the full knowledge of the process, whatever has been going on. And instead of making punitive, this is the good way, so that all this real-time data, which has been just recommended by, I think two days back, I have heard in read in Economic Times that with a committee headed by SBI Chief G.N. Bajpayee Saab, that this IBBI should have a real-time database system, data bank. So in that way, extending to this way of submitting form by the IPs or IRP or liquidator, all these progress reports, I am sorry to say that whatever report I have been asked by NCLT to submit, and I did not get any interaction or any feedback thereafter. I have filed submitting my quarterly reports to NCLT, telling the and describing the progress of a case. But in reaction, we did not get suo motu on that. Whereas in case we used to submit it to IBI or IBBI used to do it, and certainly I am confident that having a vigil over the RP with the practice what has been, they will certainly come up with the corrective actions or corrective measures, and this will improve the entire process of ICCS.
Right. And since the question has been pushed to me, I think part of the problem is legal. So most of these repositories have been created under different statutes, and the statutes place certain inherent limitations on how they can, information can be filed into them and information out of them can be used and by whom. So part of the problem is legal. So there is need for some statutory thinking on fix on how information can be used in a more cohesive way. Some of the problem, of course, will be more operational. But I think even before we arrive at the operational issues, the statutory issues stand in the way. So law has to enable it. Yes, Harsh.
I think that's well.
Yeah, Harsh.
You can say it on the mic.
At least it gives an excuse to the institution to say we have a legal problem and hence we can't share data. So,
with this, my questions are done. I'll open the the panelists to the floor. If any of you present here or any of you who have logged in through our system wish to pose any questions, please do so.
Anjay, just one before we go there, I was just thinking about what a prototype that you may think about using in order to access those databases. I don't know how they've done the national single window system, which actually cuts across central, state databases in order to provide a single view. And it's really been done, obviously, to increase the ease of doing business. Perhaps you can use whoever was driving that sure. in your quest.
I know that's a good suggestion. Yeah, so I'll open the floor to questions if there is anyone here. Okay. So I'll request anyone who's asking a question, if they wish to pose it to a specific panelist, please say so. Or if it is a more general question, again, please state so.
Yeah, it'll be a general question, please.
And please state your name so we know who you are.
I'm Debjyoti Ray Chaudhary. So first of all, I think it was a very absorbing discussion and it kept me, absolutely, on my seat. And of course, this was expected of such a distinguished panel. Now, I'd just like to make two observations. One is Anjali raises issue that, all the panelists agreed that, maybe the law should make it mandatory about the use of IU for admission. Now, Anjali has raised this issue as to whether it will be disadvantageous to certain class of creditors. So that's the specific issue I wanted to address. And I would like to say that even without making it mandatory, many such creditors are already submitting information to the IU. So in fact, private financial creditors, it's very little known that many private financial creditors are submitting information to the IU. And similarly, operation creditors, even without any mandate by law, they are still submitting information to the IU. It's still not very large, but it's still happening. And the other aspect I would like to state is that submitting information to the IU is relatively simple. And it's not very expensive as well. I think it just costs for the operational creator, it just costs around 60 rupees. So, it's not no financial aspect to this at all. Of course, I appreciate the views of the panelists regarding amendments to the law. But I was just wondering why certain provisions have not been used. In fact, I would specifically refer to section 66.2, which says that just prior to the insolvency commencement date, if the corporate debtor, the directors of corporate debtor had some idea that the corporate debtor is likely to go into insolvency, but did not take any steps to minimize the losses of the corporate debtor, then the AA, on the application made by the IP, can direct such corporate debtors to contribute to the assets of the corporate debtor. So why this provision has not been used? So then it could set a precedence, because generally what happens, as rightly pointed out many of the panelists, is that there's a lot of arguments takes place. So if such, but then this initiative has to come from the IP. And this could really set a precedent for future.
No, absolutely right. I mean, I just, personally speaking, I want to make it very clear that when I said mandatory, I mean for financial creditors. I still think that I'm aware that, of course, operational creditors also, I don't know whether it was Nikhil or Harsh, but if there are large operational creditors, I mean, Tata or L&T can also be a supplier. So they can certainly then are in a position, it's all about leverage and negotiation. So they can do it, but to make it mandatory for all OCs, then the small guy, from your caterer to the chaiwala to the security guy, he will be in a problem. Or as I said, employees. So this is just my personal view. For FCs, we have reached a stage, all FCs, it should be mandatory. And so that it is clear the benefit of it and so that everyone does it, I fully agree that make the necessary consequential amendment so that then it's very easy for NCLT also finished. In 15 days, it's done. And then there's no question everyone will do it because you want that fast. To your point of 66.2, I mean, it's a very valid point.
but scary in many ways. It's in the UK, it's often used. Here, people, I mean, I'd like to hear from Mr. Mishra and Nikhil why it's not being used, but it's a very important provision, no question about it.
This is the equivalent of the insolvent trading provision.
Because in absence of, I think, so many legal, yes, because in absence of various, for directors particularly, so many avenues to avoid the providing those things. I find that none of the IP could able to do so.
Nikhil, you want
to? Nikhil has many director friends.
No, I do, but I think it really comes down to people using it. Like if you look at other jurisdictions, right? In ours, we have hardly any of that happening in the sense that anyone's pursuing a wrongful trading case. But in the UK, it's similar. It's not really a path that's pursued because nobody is really initiating that. If you compare that to somebody, a place like Germany, for instance, in Germany, every CFO of every company will have an insolvency application in his drawer, because if it's ever found that he has been actually involved in any wrongful trading in the sense of operating the business when he knew that he would not be able to pay creditors in the future, in that instance, he would go to jail. And that worry that exists is why people don't do it, right? So in our system, nobody enforces this issue. And in our case, of course, we're very new as well. So I don't think that's the most important initiative that we should be pursuing at this particular time. There are much more important things in my mind, like, for example, the admission of cases and doing that. But that's something that we can take up subsequently, I believe.
So Harsh, I asked this question of you, but insolvent trading is a sort of a thing that in some jurisdictions, it's a big threat as to why early insolvency proceedings are filed. But in India, given that we have this environment of restructuring and which are often supported to regulatory mechanisms, how do you think an insolvent trading like provision can play out?
I don't know. I mean, it's a legal question and puzzle, and maybe because people fear that even if you pursue those cases, it'll take forever to appealed in high courts and God knows what all happens. So I think it's that. And the other thing is, and as we have seen, that there is such a strong, I hesitate to use the word bias, towards resolution and liquidation. That again, I think that sort of impacts the behavior of various stakeholders in that whole process. I think maybe these are the reasons.
Are there any other questions?
Yeah, hi. Good evening. This is Rahul Madan from IIIPI. Thank you, firstly, for the wonderful session. I can't help but making one observation, and I'll request panel's view on this particular observation in respect of the incentive structure on using these kind of PDA platforms for the IPs, and particularly if Mr. Mishra and Nikhil, if you could try and reflect upon the incentive structure. In my mind, has two aspects. One is the cost and one is the willingness. In respect of the cost, again, there are two aspects. One is the understanding has to go down very clearly that cost is acceptable as part of the IRPC, or we call it an insolvency resolution process cost, to be admitted as part of the cost. So it's taught to the pocket of the IP concerned. It is part of the IRPC. And the second aspect is that COC is the approving authority in respect of all such costs. So they will have to show the willingness to approve such kind of cost, and that fact, if goes down well, will really make some kind of difference. And the second aspect about willingness to use, this calls for the awareness, this calls for acceptability of the system and awareness on the technological or know-how by the IPs and their staff. Unless that is there, things may not move further. If you could reflect upon. Thank you.
So I think that in my mind, there are enough incentives that exist actually for insolvency professionals to use either the NESL platform or other platforms that can help them streamline the process. I can vouch for the fact that the larger insolvency professional that work with bigger cases and have larger teams in place would prefer actually to use the system versus doing it manually, and because even if the NESS system didn't exist, for instance, we have created our own system actually for operating, because we know that any moment in time during a case, or even once a case is closed, we may get a query about something that happened in the case, and we need to have that information available for 7-8 years after even the case closes. And so it's imperative, and we started that from day one actually of doing it. Now I work with a larger organization that has resources to do that, but we recover those costs from the case that for what we charge, and the clients appreciate that we are doing it in that fashion. And I believe that even smaller insolvency professionals, in the sense of the cases that they may be handling, can actually use now a system that is fairly cost effective, actually, in my mind, to use.
Yes, as per my perception, the cost which is being charged by the IU, NESL, is competitively far lesser than the actual cost which IP has to bear. So, and all this has to part and parcel of CIFP cost. So there is incentivizing, in my opinion, maybe through, there may be one way which I am thinking that if IPAs or the regulator may make it a recommendatory guidelines type of thing. Okay, IPs has to, for in a year or two, for 2 years or so, they may make the recommendatory guidelines that one should use the IU platform for digitizing their data of the corporate data. And in case it is so, then I hope that most of the this IPs, until and unless the timeline will come to near and expire, they may use it, and it may promote using all these IU facilities for all this digitizing the data.
Maybe on acceptance of application, etc., for OCs besides FCA, the threshold limit is 1 crore rupees. So I believe even for OC, someone who is having an outstanding of more than 1 crore rupees is having sufficient manpower or consultants to make an application through IU. So for acceptance of application, of course, the IU could be used completely even for OC. That is my understanding. Second, in terms of Section 66(2). It is compulsory that it has to come through an IP, that application. Now, as a code of conduct or a best practice, IP never recommends on at the time of application whether amount is due or not. He keeps himself aloof from that. So even at that time, an IP would never say whether a business is conducted fraudulently or not for the time of acceptance of application. Of course, later on when an IP comes into the seat as an IRP or RP, the matter is completely different. Third thing, maybe in terms of claims, etc., maybe an amount of about 5 lakh rupees, even of OC, could come through IU. That would be much, maybe, or a system of NESL or similar alternatives when they come up. That could be much better, and maybe digitalization of process can begin. Only claims less than 5 lakh rupees or some threshold limit can come through either firms. So that will be much better for everyone. Of course, integration already, NESL is working on the same. Now, another important point which was discussed over here, as an IP, maybe I would like to bring my point of views on that, which is the fees of maybe NESL or a similar PDA platform. Firstly, it is not only the question of cost, it is also the question of cash flow. In market, there are competitors which are giving on credit for a long period of time. Second thing, the services. Services at present of NESL are much, much lesser than what the competitors are offering. Maybe in public forum, I would like to restrict myself to these particular suggestions. off the table, other suggestions can definitely come.
Sure, sure. I think our team can get in touch with you and perhaps take more detailed feedback. So I think, as you can see, Behram has already started packing up. I think this is all the time we have for questions. So I want to thank each of you. I think I enjoyed this discussion. I hope that people in the audience and people who have joined in through the online platform also enjoyed it. Mr. Mishra, thanks a lot. I think we've met for the first time, but my pleasure. And I hope we can continue to engage with you on questions in respect of the IU and in general, your advice also.
But in fact, I am really grateful and obliged to see this forum through you, through NESL. And I thanks a lot to all audience as this, my panelists too.
Behram, as always, it's a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much for coming. And it's good to see you in person after such a long time. So thanks a lot for that.
No,
last words from you?
No, just thank you. Thank you so much for the privilege and apologies to everyone. Actually, my son is getting married in 6 days. So you can imagine what I heard from my wife when I said I'm coming here. Thank you so much.
So, Harsh, thanks again. It's always good to talk to you about banking sector issues. And I hope that much of what you've said about incentives sort of doing the job will happen. And we don't sort of, yeah, exactly. Thank you, Nikhil. Always a pleasure to talk to you. I think I read both your reports and the webinars that you recently attended with great interest to prep for this panel. So I already knew what you were going to say. So thanks a lot, everyone. Thanks to the audience. Thanks to the dignitaries. I think now I'll hand over to Neil. I'll request all of you to sort of go back to your seats. See, Behram is very happy.
Thank you, all the panel members. Now, thank you for a lively discussion, during which several interesting issues were addressed and discussed. Our next guest is Sri Rahul Madanji, MD and CEO, IIIP ICAI. Sri Madan is a qualified chartered accountant, cost and management accountant, and an insolvency professional. He has an overall professional experience of over 25 years across corporate banking, relationship management, credit and risk management, investment banking, debt advisory, structured finance, and institutional wealth management, having worked at State Bank of India, Kotak Mahindra Bank, and ICICI Bank. I now request Sri Rahul Madanji, MD and CEO, IIIP of ICAI, for a vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone, and what a power-packed session. A lot of interesting ideas, interesting thoughts came our way. Personally, I have gained a lot. I'm sure that goes to with all of you joining us physically here and virtually. I understand there are about 300 virtual participants in today's session. Really, it has picked up a lot. Initially, it was low turnout, but looking at the interest level, congratulations to all of the organizers. Thank you. And today's deliberation, I'm sure, would go a long way in not only creating the or building up the awareness level, but also bridging the so-called digital divide in the ecosystem towards efficacious and effective CRP process in the long term. And in respect of a few of the key takeaways and the quick bites in one liner, briefly, I can summarize, although we have heard a lot of luminaries in the session. The technology is indeed a force multiplier
in achieving the desired objectives of IBC, particularly the time-bound processes in a cost-effective manner and development of stressed asset market in India. And the another one I can, and a couple of them are the PDA solutions are, as we know, the multifaceted across end-to-end case management as is offered by the NESL, record of default, e-auction platform, evaluation of the plans, interim finance arrangement platform, and the storage of data, and of course, e-voting and other related facilities. And the cost of these all IT systems are gradually and significantly coming down. That goes to the advantage of all of the users, and the usage and the awareness level has certainly to go up, and that is need of the hour and the center of the focus we need to apply our minds on. NESL in this regard is playing a significant and a decisive role, and we wish them all the best in their endeavors. And due to the COVID particularly, I should not be using the word blessing, but certainly it is a blessing in disguise for amplified and advanced usage of the IT or technological solutions. And we need to ramp up and take the momentum forward for sure. And for NCLT related processes, as we came to know through the discussions today, the first steps or the initial steps have been taken for the digitization, but more could be needed, more could be anticipated. For example, the suggestions came in the form of a tick mark based approach or the template based ordering system, and some also apt suggestions in respect of the legislative changes needed on the record of default being made mandatory, etc. So I think that will go a long way. And particularly, I want to touch upon in towards the end, big ticket announcement. And let me congratulate Shukla sir on the IBC 21. That is much awaited and the long awaited announcement we were waiting. And please join me a big hand on this announcement. And we are looking forward to it, which will really significantly make a difference to all of the stakeholders. And also the COC code of conduct anticipated soon, and also the cross-border framework will very soon see the light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you for those announcements, Shukla sir. And at the end, I think have to summarize all of the discussion today, I think technologically, the convergence is the mantra, convergence is the way to go. Continuous evolution is the way to go for all the stakeholders, not only for digitization, but also digitalization, as we understand the difference. Personally, I was not very conversant, but these differences really make a difference, make a better understanding. With that, with these positive thoughts, I express my heartfelt gratitude to our eminent guest speakers today, Honorable Member NCLT, Shri Venkat Subha Rao Hariji. Thank you for joining us. And Shri Sudhakar Shukla Ji, whole-time member, IBBI, Shri Subrata Biswas, Deputy Managing Director, SBI, Dr. Ashok Haldia, Chairman, IIIPI, joining from Delhi, Mr. Dev Jyoti Chaudhary, MD, NESL, as a co-host, and also our eminent panelist in the panel discussion, Shri Behram Vakil Ji, Mr. Nikhil, Brijendra Kumar Mishra Ji, and Mr. Harshvardhan. And big thanks at the end to all our audience joining virtually as well as physically for patient listening and being a great audience. And I would be falling in my duty if I do not express my heartfelt thanks to the organizing committee and organizing team, particularly ICI, who has been a great host and allowing us to use this great facility. Fantastic experience. With that, thank you. Good day and namaskar.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we have now come to an end of the seminar. I thank you for your participation and request all of you present to kindly join us for high tea on the first floor. Thank you.